فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Third one is they debate, they prohibited النهي عن المناظرات التي يبينها أصحابها على الشك. They also warned against debating people, okay, whose foundation is something you're not going to agree with. For example, the innovators and even the atheists, the Christians, and their foundation is what? Like, for example, not recently, but a while back, I remember watching Richard Dawkins in a discussion that he had with, what's that chubby Irish guy again? John Lennox, when they had it in the sculpture, the dinosaur. So, it was probably there or somewhere else, but it was the two of them. So he said something about that the foundation in which he believes that things to be observed, his worldview is skepticism, doubt everything. There's nothing really certain. That's a problem, that foundation. You can't debate with a person like that. A person who believes everything should by default should be doubted, and we need to move away from doubt towards certainty. So the assess of everything is shak. You both won't agree. Do you see? That person, they won't entertain that idea. And debating that person like that will not bring about any benefit. Does that make sense? Because that person's argument is going to be, well, prove to me you're even here. I've got the rights to doubt your existence right now. Does that make sense? And the debate has to have a foundation where we can pick up from. Something we agree upon. That's where we start off, right? Common ground. But there's no common ground. There's nothing we can both agree on. Nothing. There's zero. Even my existence right now, it doesn't, you don't have it no more. Are you with me, brothers? So since that doesn't exist, entertaining that idea of debating that person also, tahadir salaf, the salaf warned against that. You want to debunk that person? Do your authorship. Write books on them. Do lessons on them. Write things like that about them, articles, journals, whatnot. But to bring them forward to the people, it's not correct. And debate them. Number four is debates which bring about more debates. Something that's argument and a debate that's going to bring about more. It's going to bring out more tanazzul, more ikhtilaf. That basically what you're opening is not going to just stay there. You're going to debate, and this debate is going to turn out to be what? Something else is going to stem from it, which then will become a debate. And that something is going to give something else something. And that is just going to go more. And that's really the previous one. It's the same as the previous one. Are you there? People who were atheists, when they got debated, and debate was open with them, they're going to go home, remember. And they're going to work on their debate tactics. So then they're going to have to see where it went wrong for them and what was causing them to basically get caught. And it was that they found out that they were holding on to the principle of certainty first. So what they did was they removed that now. So they come back now and the debate has become more disgusting. Are you with me? So that's why a debate that's going to give birth to what's worse shouldn't be done. Number five. Debates that are based upon accepting some of the evidences and not really wanting to accept the others. Are you with me? A debate that's based upon believing some of the textual evidences and not the rest, they also warn against a debate like that. And that's common. Some people are pushing forward debaters whose aqeedah is actually not to take Qabr al-Ahad. Are you with me, brothers? This man doesn't take singular narration in aqeedah. And he's been put forward and he's been told to debate, and he's going out there, he's debating. And guess what? As he's debating, okay, or as he's talking in a discussion debate, he comes up with his gharaib. And so the people are looking at him as he's the one who's debating the kafir, and they're Muslim. So they're looking at the Muslim as one they're relating to. Are you with me? And so it's what brings about, what do you call it? It brings about that concept now creeps into the people. Are you with me, brothers? It's very dangerous. Madalika, many debaters that we see today, I'm just ala sabili tamthil, just for you guys. It won't be in the recording, inshallah ta'ala. Is, what's his name, the debater, Shabir Ali, you know him, right? He's got aqidah issues. Very, very dangerous aqidah issues. Very serious aqidah issues. But he's a good debater with Christians. Amazing, profound, and like, wow, eloquent, points, boom, boom. But he doesn't take all the textual evidence, does he? Yeah, he does not take all the textual evidence. So for him, he's going to debate from a whole different perspective when he's debating. Are you there? And within a debate, he'll dismiss points that are nusus wahiyin, kitab and sunnah. Are you with me? So the debate, like, the salaf don't want against it. Are you there? The salaf were against it. أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Are you going to believe in some of the evidences and you're going to reject the other? So they'll say, for example, and I've seen people do that. Like, for example, one individual told me that he doesn't, he was debating al-Rafidi al-Shi'i. So he asked the Shi'i, can you bring the evidences for the Imamah from the Qur'an or the Sunnah? Look how the debating and ignorance of himself has actually brought him to this problem. So he goes, I don't affirm when it comes to usul of the religion, and the only thing I consider from the usul is basically what was found in the Qur'an. Because when I'm debating al-Rafidi, if I say Dajjal exists, and he says to him, where is it in the Qur'an? And I say, it's in the Sunnah. He's going to say to him, well, the Imam is in my Sunnah as well. Let's take it. Look what happened to him. Are you with me? So he's belittling his Sunnah because he's scared and worried that the Rafidi is going to say, I'm going to take my kitab, Usul al-Kafi. There is, if Imam is here for me. Are you with me, brothers? But on the grounds that Usul al-Kafi is no asanid al-riwayat, which are correct, authentic, yours does. So you're going to dismiss your one because you're worried about that. You see what happens here? So this is very common in people who are not grounded, who don't have Islamic knowledge, and who want to believe in some of the textual evidences. They actually give up because they know that in the debate this is going to happen. So they don't want to get caught. So they actually dismiss evidences. Are you with me? Number six is the Salaf, they prohibited refuting innovation with innovation, which is also what we just clearly mentioned before. You're basically, it's called رَدُّ الْبِدْعَةِ بِبِدْعَةٍ أُخْرَى. You're basically refuting innovation with another innovation. So you're initiating something right, something what? وَلِذَلْكَ عَلَيْهِ I think it was Imam Ahmad رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ عَبْدُ ibn Mahdi, sorry, it was AbdulRahman ibn Mahdi. It was told him that a man refuted al-bid'ah. And he said, "Bil Kitab wa Sunnah." Was it with the Kitab and Sunnah? And he said to him, "No." And so he said that what he has done is bid'ah refuted with bid'ah. I could be right if you wish to. No problem. You can even be my brother if you want to. Does that make sense? If you refute batil with another batil, I'm against the batil, not who said it. Are you with me? Just because you said batil doesn't mean it's good, and he says batil because I don't like him. I'm not gonna. Does that make sense? Batil is batil, whoever says it doesn't matter. So you're not allowed to refute falsehood with falsehood, not in any way, form or shape. And this is a problem comes. Another problem comes. which is people will see a person who they're with refuting a misguided person, refuting what? A misguided person. And so they'll be silent about him. Pay attention, it's problematic now. So you're with me, I go and I debate with somebody. They bring an innovation, I create an innovation to respond to this, to get rid of his innovation. My group know that what I've just done is innovation. They're going to be silent about it, and they're not going to respond to me about it. They're not going to correct me on that. Are you with me? So what I've not don't know what I've, the problem is that I did remove his innovation, but I brought another innovation in place. So have I brought any good? I've not brought any good. So then you as an individual should be upset. Why? Okay, our point, we came here is to get rid of an innovation. We came here to get rid of a misguidance. And you've just created and initiated another one. Does that make sense? So we've not left with victory, did we? We ain't left with that. That's important. So those are the points, brothers, and many more, but those are the most prominent things why the Salaf prohibited from debating, and debating it not being something that they warn against in their books now. They spoke against it. The characteristics of the one who's debating Ahlul Batil. What are the characteristics that a person who's debating the people of misguidance needs to come with? The first characteristics is that each and every one of them because we previously mentioned the characteristics of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, their distinct characteristics in now we're going to speak about the innovators and the people of misguidance. Are you with me, brothers? How they are when it comes to debating. So you're going to see a lot of these characteristics prominent today in many people. The first one is each of those deviated people, whether it's disbelievers or not, أن كل واحد منهم يتعصب لفرقتي ولأصحابي. There's ta'asub, fanaticism, صح? They're all fanatic towards their what? To their group and their people. They're very fanatic towards them. Ta'asub. You find that very prominent in them. Number two is that through their debates, it gives birth to disunity and even more debates. Like for example, if you look at the deviated groups, they break up into even more. They become, yesterday they were together, they become different groups now. Different groups. So they're debating people of misguidance, it breaks them up even more and they become, does that make sense? It does. Whereas Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, since they're only on one path, which is قال الله, قال الرسول, قال الصحابة, they don't differ. They agree. They don't oppose one another. These ones, yesterday they were together, today they do tabdi' of each other or takfir. يُكَفِّرُ بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا. And they do tabdi' of each other. All because of what? All because of debates and discussions that would bring this about. So this is what you find with them. Number three. When you look at Ahlul Batil and their debates and their discussions, you find their speech is what? Hashwan kathira fil kalam. They speak too much, but really what they just said was, it could have been said in three words or four words. And they'll speak for half an hour. It's really not, it hasn't got substance in it. It's a lot of words, fancy words, boom, 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 all day. You know, he's speaking 45 minutes. I could summarize that whole into 3 to 4 minutes of what he just said, bullet points. That's all he said. Nothing other than that which he said. Are you with me? That's how they are. You'll find that very prominent in them. And it's even more because politics is like that, right? That's the whole point of politics. They give you a 45 minute slot, you talk and you have to leave that pulpit and you have to not hurt anybody. Is that possible? But they'll do that in the sense where their speeches are so ambiguous and it's too much and he'll say something, and he will nullify it again, and he'll go back on it again, and he'll say it, and it just, you don't know, who are you with? Are you for or against? Which one are you on? Ah. Are you with me, brothers? That's why the people say, you know, leave kalam siyasi, don't stop this political speech, man. Stop being a politician. Ah. Huh? The reason is because they can't get a point across easily. They won't. They'll talk for an hour or so. And is he going to do it for us or is he not? That's what you're still asking yourself. It was the initial question at the beginning. Okay, the fourth is they enter into the evidence. But they place introductions for it. Those introductions that they place for the evidences, okay, it does not bring the results which they're looking for. And all of this, inshallah ta'ala, many examples we will take in the Allah al-Kareem. Also, the fifth one, which is, and this is very powerful, أَنَّهُمْ يُعَمِّمُونَ حُكْمَ الصُّورَةِ الشَّاذَّةِ أَوْ الْمُسْتَثْنَاتِ. It's very common in debates. They take exceptions and they want to make the exception the general ruling. So every qa'idah and every principle, you're always going to find what? You're going to find exceptions. That's an exception of the principle. That does not remove the asal though. The qa'idah that is here, the qa'idatul mustamirra, which is the asal in this issue. Are you with me? For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He prohibited the eating of corpse, dead animals. Okay? But there is a istithna, which is when there's a necessity, of course. Necessity can't override the ruling of prohibition. This is an exception. So nobody can come to me if I say corpse are haram, dead animals are haram. You now can't come and say to me, well, what about necessity? Well, the necessity is an istithna, is an exception. An exception cannot overrun. Are you there? That's an excluded, you know, narrowed down specific situation. The general ruling that we hold by is that it's what? Now, what they would do is, they will say, pay attention, dead animals or corpse are haram. Sorry, halal. He says, Akhi Taqila, what are you talking about? He says, what about darura? So he's made it now into a what? Hukum am. He made it a general ruling. Are you with me? Or what he will do is he will take an opinion which is shad, strange opinion. And he will make that strange opinion the hukum which is am. Are you with me? That's common in their debates and their arguments with you. So you need to know and say, this is yaqi, this is istithna, it's an exception. Why are you trying to make it a general ruling? The sixth one is, they have foundations that are batil. Their foundation is so weak and it's so ridiculous. Because of that, they are not able to debate the mushrikeen. They really can't. Ahlul bid'ah can't debate the mushriks. They can't. If the kaf, the mushrik, actually studies the ahlul bid'ah, he's actually able to go into the root of their problem and destroy them. That's the truth. Mubtadi'ah don't have the ability to debate with the mushrikeen. I'll give you an example. A Jew man was called to come to Islam. A mubtadi' wanted to call a Jew into Islam. So the Yahudi man said, Allahu lam yurid Islami. Allah doesn't want my Islam. Allah doesn't want me to become a Muslim. In other words, if he did, he would have brought me into Islam. So he doesn't want me to become a Muslim, he said. So he used qadr as an excuse, right? Allah destined for me to become a Yahudi. So look at this, he's a mubtadi'. So he said to him, no, Allah wants you to come into Islam, but it's shaitan doesn't want you to come into Islam. It's shaitan that doesn't want to for you to surrender. And then this is the qa'id of Ahlul Bid'ah. And he responded and he said that this is a shaytan that's stronger than Allah. هذا شيطان قوي يغلب ربه. This is a shaytan that is even stronger than God. His one went by through and Allah's one didn't. So this is just an example of ضعف مجادلة بعض أصحاب الفرق الباطلة للمشركين. It's just a prime example of mushrik trying, the mubtadi' trying to debate a mushrik. Because Ahlul Sunnah would have said that Allah's irada is two types. Irada kawniya and irada shara'iya. Universally, he didn't want you to. نعم. Like in shara'a, he wants you to come into it. خلاص قضي الأمر. They don't believe that. That's not their belief. They can't say that. Because if they do, then they will leave the whole belief of their qadari concept and come into. Does that make sense? So the path that they took allows the mushrik to beat them. Because their foundation is very bad and it's null and void. Are you with me, brothers? So, with those reasons, or with those characteristics, is what you find Ahlul Bid'ah holding on to. Now, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to speak about the books that are written and the authorships that have come in place regarding mu'allafatu fi ilm al-jadal. The books that have been written in ilm al-jadal. Many books have been written here, whether it be fiqh, whether it be usul al-fiqh, whether it be in tafsir of the Quran, whether it even be in books of aqa'id, you find debates and everything is in there. But the early discovered, the early documented books in jadal debates was the jadal al-fiqhiyu ala tariqati al-fuqaha'i al-mutaqaddimin. The early documented books were the books that were written according to the fuqaha, the jurists, the early generation fuqaha, the books that they wrote in fiqh. They authored fiqh in a way of debate, an argument, discussions, dialogue. For example, if you look at Imam al-Shafi'i in his kitab al-Risala, sorry, yeah, his Ummah. Imam al-Shafi'i, if you look at his kitab al-Ummah, with the riwayah of Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, was his student. He's a student of who? Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. If you look at it, you find very strong, tough, powerful dialogue going between, taking place between Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. So when you read Kitab al-Ummah by Imam al-Shafi'i, the way they're going at each other and the way it's taking place is profound, it's amazing. It teaches you malaka fiqhiyya. You become very grounded in fiqh. You won't just learn what your evidence is, but you will learn how to argue for your evidences and how to counter-react and respond to the evidences that the opponent has brought forward. If you read the books written by Ibn al-Mundhir, rahimahullah, again, Ibn al-Mundhir's kitab is also Jadal al-Fiqh ala tariqati al-fuqaha al-mutaqaddimin. Ibn al-Mundhir, rahimahullah, has written, his books are very powerful in that regard, and you benefit from that. Also, if you read the books of Ibn Hazm al-Dhahiri, rahimahullah, and his kitab al-Muhalla, kitab al-Muhalla is a powerful book in this way, where Ibn Hazm tackles and argues his points and debates with the people who are against him. So Ibn Hazm is very powerful in this regard, very strong and very tough to prove his point. That if you read his book seriously, you would not believe that there's anything right other than what he said. The way he can argue his points, they're very profound. So these are the early works that are written in his regard. Rather, the scholars, they used to call their books Kitab al-Khilafiyat. It's called Khilafiyat. It's just recently that they started to call it Fiqh al-Muqaran. In universities, they call it now Fiqh al-Muqaran, comparative fiqh. Fiqh al-Muqaran is what? Comparative fiqh. But they didn't know that as before. Before it wasn't called Fiqh al-Muqaran. It was used to be called, it was referred to as Khilafiyat. Khilafiyat means differences, disagreements. That's what it's called. And the Shafi'iyya were the early ones who authored it. And I'm not saying that because I'm a Shafi'i myself. But it is. The early one who wrote it, his name is Abu Hamid al-Tabari al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. Abu Hamid al-Tabari wrote it. The Ahnaf, claimed that they were the early ones to write it. But they discovered this 100 years after Shafi'iyya were in it. They discovered this 100 years after the Shafi'iyya went into it. One of the scholars that wrote it for them is the Kitab al-Tajrid, written by Abu Hussein al-Quduri, rahimahullah ta'ala. He has works in that. Bayhaqi also has Kitab al-Khilafiyyat, which I think now has been finished in all of it. Previously, Sheikh Mashur Hassan Ali Salman, he released, I think, a volume or two from it. But now, alhamdulillah, they've published even more. I don't know if they've finished all of it, but I know they've published it. Again, Ibn al-Mundhir, I already mentioned him. His Kitab al-Awsat, Ajib. You read it, he leaves you amazed with him. And Al-Imam ibn al-Hazm, which I already spoke about. There's also the Ahnaf Abu Zayd al-Dabusi, rahimahullah, his Kitab Ta'sis al-Nadar, which when this book first came out, the Shafi'iyya believed that Ilm al-Jadal was for them. This was their tariqah, especially Jadal al-Fiqhi, ala tariqah al-Mutaqaddimin. So the Shafi'iyya believed that they were the ones that were carrying the banner of this. And so what they did was, they really wanted to respond to this book, Kitab Ta'sis al-Nadar, written by Abu Zayd al-Dabusi. They wanted to respond to him and to give him an answer of what he wrote. Because he was writing it according to the Hanafi madhab. And he was, and again, if it is a kitab which is jadali based on debate, he's going to prove his arguments against them, right? So he was refuting their points. So it really hurt the Shafi'iyya, and this book stayed around for a very long time. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brought Abu Muzaffar al-Sam'ani. Abu Muzaffar al-Sam'ani, he used to be, for 30 years he was a Hanafi, and 20 years he became a Shafi'i. For 30 years he was upon their madhab, and he knew them inside out. So he came out and he wrote his book, Qawatu' al-Adillah. And it became a book, the Shafi'iyya, that they said if there could be a book weighed according to, a book that could be weighed in gold, it would have been this book. For them it was a thorn in their neck, the Kitab Ta'sis al-Nadhar, written by Abu Zayd al-Dabusi. And when Abu Muzaffar came and he wrote that book, and it's a book when you both read Abu Zayd al-Dabusi's Kitab Ta'sis al-Nadhar, you find that he brings so much textual evidences, mashallah. Adilla al-Naqliya, mashallah, which are a lot authentic. And he brings a lot of aql, rationality, which someone would benefit. And Abu Muzaffar al-Sam'ani's kitab, Qawatu' al-Adillah, there is no kitab like it, unprecedented. Especially his kitab is far from ilm al-kalam and ilm al-falsafa, is dalil and adillah in usul al-fiqh and qawa'id al-fiqhiyya. From the scholars who actually wrote in these fields and brought out books is the kitab written by Abu al-Hasan ibn Ali, ibn Umar ibn Ahmad al-Baghdadi al-Maliki, whose name is known as Ibn Qassar, rahimahullah. He wrote a book called Uyun al-Adillah fi al-Masail al-Khilaf bayna fuqaha al-Amsar. This book, Uyun al-Adillah, Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi stood over it and he saw this book and the method and the way it was written, and he was gobsmacked by it, Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, the author of the Luma' and the kitab that Imam Muslim explains, which is Al-Majmu'ah, is the Sharh of Al-Muhadda by Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. Nawawi is explaining of Al-Majmu' is a sharah of the Kitab Al-Muhadhab by Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi said, Ashabun al-Shafi'iyya. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi said, Us Shafi'is, this book written by Ibn Qassar, Lam yu'allifu mithlahu, they've never authored anything like it. And then Tajuddin al-Subki came and this is to show you the ta'assub of the madhab. When Tajuddin al-Subki came and he saw that Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi had said that, and they are so against the Ahnaf and the other Madahibs, especially the Ahnaf and even the Malikiyya later. What happened was, Ibn Qassar was a Maliki. Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, when he said that, Tajuddin al-Subki came and he blasted Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi, even though Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi is from the same madhab as his. And he said, what is he talking about? Yeah, Ibn Qassar's kitab is nothing. And so he belittled that, because this is a group, this is ta'assub, this is what madhhab brings. That was the first one, which is called, that one was called Al-Jadal al-Fiqhi fi tariqat al-fuqaha al-mutaqaddimin. There's another type of jadal which you find, which is Jadal al-Usuli. The Usuliyin, they have jadal books, which are very amazing, it's good to read. Khasatan when it comes to Babu Qiyas, the chapter of Qiyas, an analogy, when you look at that chapter, that's when it comes out, when they're talking about the illah and the reasonings. That's where they have to use a lot of debates and arguments. Na'am. And Imam Al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, in his Mustasfa, he took, before back in the days, Usulul Fiqh and Ilmul Jadal used to be emerged together, because that's how it started off. Until Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali came. When Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali came, he got rid of Ilmul Jadal from within Usulul Fiqh. Because in the chapter of Qiyas, they all used to bring it in there. Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali came and he wrote his kitab Al-Mustasfa. And Al-Mustasfa is the kitab Ibn Qudama summarized and took out also some things, which is Rawdatul Nadir wa Jannatul Munadir. Ibn Qudama's kitab Rawdatul Nadir wa Jannatul Munadir is a summary and work taken from Mustasfa Abu Hamid Al-Ghazali. He took out some things, Ilm al-Kalam and stuff like that are in there as well. And he also got rid of what he is not in agreement with according to his madhab. But the Mustasfa Abu Hamid was the first one who got Ilm al-Jadal from Bab al-Qiyas and took it out. And he left it for Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, he left it for his Kitab al-Muntaqil fi al-Jadali. He left it for that book. Also from the scholars that wrote in this field of Ilm al-Jadal, Jadal al-Usuliyu, is Al-Imam al-Haramain, his Kitab al-Kafiyah fi al-Jadali, li-Abi Ma'ali al-Joini rahimahullah. It's a kitab written in Al-Jadal al-Usuli, Usul al-Fiqh in a Jadali manner. Also, Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi's kitab, Al-Ma'unatu fi al-Jadali, Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi al-Shafi'i. He also has a mulakhas of fi al-Jadali, Abu Ishaq al-Shirazi. I forgot to mention that in the Jadal al-Fuqaha ala tariqat al-Mutaqaddimin, Ibn Aqil al-Hambri has a book on it. It's called Al-Jadal ala tariqat al-Fuqaha, which is published. It's matbu'un, it's mutadawal. He has it. He's the author of the Kitab al-Wadih. In the Muqaddimah, he really talks about Jadal al-Usuli, and I advise the students of knowledge, if you can go to that Kitab, the al-Wadih, which he wrote, the Muqaddimah, he speaks about it. From the books that are written in this field as well is Al-Abhari's Kitab Al-Qawadih, Al-Jadaliyah, Al-Muqtarih by Barwi, Al-Tufi's Kitab Al-Jadal fi Fann al-Jadal, Idah li-Qawanin al-Istilah, written by Abu Muhammad ibn al-Jawzi, which is the son of Ibn al-Jawzi, and many other scholars have written it. Books have come out regarding it. So the talib ilm, the student of knowledge, is to give some form of attention to it. Read those works and those authorships that are being put together. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll have a 45-minute break, inshallah ta'ala. We'll come back. We'll speak about, for another 45 minutes, inshallah ta'ala, the most common terms that are used in ilm al-jadal. Just defining each term that they use and what they mean by it. And we will conclude there and leave it for, inshallah ta'ala, the book. We will leave it for, inshallah, Saturday. So now, inshallah, you'll try to all be back by 11 o'clock, inshallah ta'ala. If you can be back by 11.